The surprisingly simple physics of a laser. The laser is one of the most important tools for teasing cats. In this video, I'll show you some properties of the atom and how the atom interacts with light. Then I'll use that knowledge to simulate a working laser. This video was brought to you by very generous Patreon supporters. Thank you. The whole process of lasering relies on a special interaction between the atom and the light. For simplicity, let's just look at an atom with two orbitals and of course with the nucleus in the center. The picture of the atom is completely wrong, but it gets the physics right because the two states here represent energy levels for the electron. As you know, electrons can only exist in a state and not between two states. And when it switches states, it will do what's called a quantum jump. It's simply just a transition where it kind of jumps or teleports to another state. It will never be found in between. But this transition requires some energy. One way to get that energy is for the electron to absorb a photon. That's called stimulated absorption. Once the electron is in an excited state, it will return to a lower state after some time. It will relax, and we call that spontaneous emission. And of course, the energy that the electron had will have to go somewhere, and so it goes to a photon, so it will be sent out in a random direction. Any photon that interacts with the atom won't necessarily excite it. The photon needs to have the exact same energy as the energy difference between the two states in order to excite the electron. So for example, the energy difference could be 2 electron volts. So when a photon of incorrect energy, say a photon of 5 electron volts, that's the ultraviolet spectrum, if that passes through the atom, then it has too much energy and it can't excite the atom into that state. But a 2 electron volt red photon have the correct energy, and so it can excite the electron. After some time, the electron will relax and it will send out the same energy photon 2 electron volts in a random direction. So now we're already ready to explain a concept here. Did you have these self-glowing stars as a kid? You know, you put them in the room and then they light up at dark. How did that work? Well, we can use our neural knowledge to explain that actually. The atom in the plastic have been illuminated by white light, and white light contains all frequencies, red, blue, green, and so on. And so when the plastic have been illuminated in the daylight, it will absorb a green photon because that's just the energy it needs. Then something new happens. The excited state in this plastic, or these atoms in the plastic, have a very long lifetime. It's called a metastable state. And the reason why it has to do with quantum mechanics, specifically the selection rules. So the electron will just sit excited, and after some long time it will de-excite or relax and undergo spontaneous emission hours later at night. And this whole process is called phosphorescence. Now back to our atom. It turns out there's one more type of interaction between atom and light. It's called stimulated emission. This interaction can happen if the electron is excited and then a photon of the same energy as the energy difference between the two states passes by. Example, we see an excited atom and then 2 electron volts photon flies by and interact with it, and it will kind of tickle it or cause it to send out another photon, so it will de-excite and send out another photon. And now what's really important here for laser is this new photon generated from the interaction has some very important features. It has an identical phase, identical frequency, polarization, and directions for the photon that interacting with the atom. Because the frequency is the same, the color or the energy is the same, of course, as well. And therefore, we call these 2 photons monochromatic. And the identical phase is called coherence. So now that we understand the concept of atom-light interaction, we are almost ready to build a laser. And the laser is an abbreviation of light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So you can kind of tell the lasers work by exploiting the stimulated emission interaction, and let me show you how. But first, I later need to draw many atoms clumped together and photons on top of each other. So let's just simplify the notation or the visualization. So instead of this huge atom here, I'll show the photon as a small arrow and the atom as a gray circle. The atom is red when it has an excited state. We can also represent stimulated emission with this new representation. To exploit the stimulated emission process, let's make what's called an optical cavity. It's a cylinder with mirrors on the side. So when photon hits the mirror, they'll change direction. But when the photons hit the outer wall, there's just some glass, so they'll just exit out of the cylinder. Inside the optical cavity, there'll be what's called a gain medium. It's simply a material that can perform stimulated emission for us. And real world example could be a ruby crystal or helium neon gas. The cavity will also contain what's called an optical pump. Actually, there'll be multiple pumps all around the circumference of the cavity, but I'll just draw one on the top. The pump is basically just a really strong flashlight. The pump can be tuned to send out two electron volts photons. So when the flash pump, there'll be a lot of photons everywhere, really chaotically inside the cavity. That looks way too confusing, so let's just make a rule. Let's say when the pump flashes, instead of drawing all these photons, the atoms will have a 50% chance of getting hit by a photon. Approximately half of the atoms get hit, and so they get excited, and later they spontaneously emit a photon. So we are almost ready to produce a laser. Obviously, there should be many more atoms in the cavity for it to work as a gain medium. But the idea of producing laser light is, we will continuously excite with the pump. Then we wait for one of the atoms to send out a photon orthogonal to the mirrors. Then the photon will bounce around, and we will hope that this photon will hit an excited electron such that the atom can undergo stimulated emission. Suddenly, there will be two photons orthogonal to the mirrors. And then they hit another, then there will be three, and then another, then four, and that's the way we create this coherent monochromatic light wave. So let me show you that idea by placing a photon orthogonal to the mirrors. And I'll excite some atoms with the pump. I don't know if you see it, but at one instant we actually got our photon amplified to three photons, but it quickly got absorbed because the atoms weren't excited. So that's an easy fix, right? Let's just flash with the pump again and again and again to excite our atoms. It seems like we fixed our problem, but we introduced a new problem. Atoms that are still excited when the pump flashes again will undergo a stimulated emission from the pump light. The light from the pump comes from a random direction, and so this stimulated emission will also be in a random direction, not something we want. So there's a huge problem with our setup. I'll put in more atoms and let's see what happens when I keep flashing the pump. That looks really confusing, but what I wanted to show you is, no matter what we do, it's physically impossible to have more than 50% of the atoms in the cavity excited at once. Why is that then? Let's say we are magically at the point where 50% are excited and 50% are not excited in the cavity. And we want more to be excited, so we just flash some more, right? In order to excite the atoms. Well, that will just simply invert the atoms, because all the atoms that weren't excited will of course then be excited. But all the atoms that were already in the excited state, they will get hit by a photon from the flash pump, then undergo stimulated emission and de-excite. So we are still at 50-50% excited. It's a huge problem, because we can't multiply photons in the system, because if we send down a photon in a system where there's under 50% excited, then there will be over 50% interaction with de-excited atoms, and that just eats our system. So we want not just 50-50, because then on average nothing will happen. We want more than 50% of the atoms to be excited. By the way, when more than 50% of the atoms are excited in the lasing state, we call this population inversion. So we need to change something in order for our laser to work. The fix is actually quite simple. We'll just find an atom with three states instead. This atom has a higher energy state available, and it could be, for example, the 5 electron volts, the UV photon that the 2-level atom could not absorb. So here in this example, a 5 electron volt ultraviolet photons interact with the electron, and at a later time, the electron will undergo spontaneous emission and fall down to state 2 and send out a blue 3 electron volt photon. And of course now the energy is 2 electron volts, so it will sit in state 2, and at a later time it will fall down again and send out that 2 electron volt photon. Which you might know from UV parties. In this UV picture, the room is actually filled up with UV light rays, but your eyes cannot see that frequency, so the room appears dark. But if we have a 3-level atom material, then it can absorb the ultraviolet, then it will spontaneously emit to state 2 and then later to state 1. We could not see the 5 electron volt with our eyes, but it fell down from 3 to 2 and sent out a 3 electron volt photon, blue photon, that our eyes can see. And then later the photon fell down to state 1 and sent out a 2 electron volt, and our eyes can see that as well. The picture here shows there are some body paints with this process where it absorbs invisible light from our eyes, but then it undergoes photoluminescence and sends out green and orange light that our eyes can actually see. So let me quickly mention one last mechanism of the atom or a molecule state. You can also have a radiationless transition, where the electron quantum jumps does not send out a photon. Of course, the energy difference has to go somewhere when it isn't converted to a photon. And for example, it could go to something else like kinetic energy, or it could go to vibrational or rotational relaxation. But we won't care about the process. We care about that the electron can switch states without sending out a photon. And that's beneficial for the population inversion if we use the atom that goes from state 3 to state 2 in a radiationless transition. We would also like the atoms to have another key features actually. So first, transition from 3 to 2 should have a very short lifetime. Transition 2 to 1 should be a major stable state, such that the lifetime is much longer. Alright, so let's just switch to the other representation again for the atom. Of course, there are 6 possible different actions. The atom can be absorbed from state 1 to 2, formed with 2 electron volts. The atom can be excited from state 1 to 3 with a 5 electron volt photon. There is radiationless transition from 3 to 2. It happens very fast, of course, in our atom. Then there can also be stimulated emission from state 2 to 1. Then there can be stimulated emission from state 3 to 1. Then we have a metastable state at state 2, and it can spontaneously emit to state 1. But it happens with a very long lifetime. So let's put our new 3 atom level in the cavity. The pump flash energy will now configure to send out 5 electron volts. The energy needed to excite our atom in the state 3. So as before, each time the pump flashes, all the atoms will have a 50% chance of being hit. Let's run the system. And you can see now we are able to obtain population inversion. More than 50% of the atom is excited. Since state 3 will quickly de-excite to a much more stable state, state 2, over 50% of the atom can easily be excited. Now the flash will not relax atom in state 2 because the energy is 5 electron volts and not the same 2 electron volts. Excited photons will have a much higher chance of getting amplified by stimulated emission instead of getting eaten by absorption. To make a working laser now, we just need the laser to run for some time. And of course, if we want to get light out, we will simply just let one mirror reflect photons with a 90% chance, such that 10% of the photons are being sent out. And that mirror is called the output coupler, while the other mirror will reflect 100% of the light, and that mirror is called the high reflector. So in this animation, I'm not showing you these mirrors because it's easy to imagine. The cavity built up a high number of coherent photons. So I'll stop the simulation now, but I'll put in a link so you can let the simulation run for some more time if you want. So you saw a huge number of photons was built up, and these photons are made from stimulated emission, so the direction, phase, polarization, frequency is identical. And this triangle representation of the photons does not really clearly show how nice the resulting light is. So if we switch to the old wave representation for the photon, it shows how nice and aligned the photons are. So that's the light coming out of the laser. Nice. And of course, in a real laser, photons will bounce around in the mirror a billion times per second, and there will be billions of atoms in the cavity as well. So cool physics, infinite scientific uses, the best cat toy makes lasers one of the best discoveries of all times. Happy lasering. If you want to help me make more animations, you can become a patron for the price of whatever you like to pay. So thank you very much. I hope you found it interesting. See you.